I am Dr. Camillus Kasala of the Eastern Africa Statistical Training Center. I have followed Professor Lumumba's presentation. I would like to submit to us that this, what I'm going to say, will be the summary of his presentation, very short. There is no hygiene in African politics because of what I call the not always vicious circle. This circle begins with what is logical in African politics is not always practical. What is practical is not always right. What is right is not always ethical. What is ethical is not always desired. And what is desired takes us back to what is not always logical. Now, what is the hygiene? Mwalimu Nyerere avoided what I call temptations of five P's. And I would like the young people here to listen very, very carefully, because the world today is everywhere broadcasting these five P temptations. Please, future African leaders, the young people, avoid the first P. Avoid being the victim of the first P. The first P is power. Avoid being the victim of the second P, property. Avoid being the victim of the third P, prestige. Avoid being the victim of the fourth P, popularity. And avoid being the victim of the last P, pomposity. Waswahili wanaitwa, wanaita mbwe mbwe. Mziepuke hizo zote. Asante sana.
Thank you very much.
Naitwa Nikki wa pili, ni msanii wa rap. Duri sana. Lakini kwangu mimi nasema, ukombozi wa Afrika, hautaletwa na Messiah, Masi. Hata ukiwasoma kina Mwalimu, kina Kabrala, kina Sankara, waliogopa sana hiyo dhana ya umasihi ambao sisi wote tunayabudu. Leo tumejaa kwa sababu anakuja Profesa Lumumba. Ni dhana ya umasihi. Hakuna wakulima hapa wamekuja kutoa mada. Hao ndio wanaishi umaskini kila siku. Hakuna wakonda, hakuna wapiga debe. Kuna hiyo hierarchy ya kuhodhi maarifa. Sisi wasomi ndio tutaongea. Wale wanyonge tumewaacha. Kwa hiyo kwangu mimi nataka kukazia kwamba mapinduzi pekee ambayo yataikomboa Afrika kwanza ni kuvunja huo mfumo mzima wa uchumi na kubadilisha mfumo kama mwalimu alivyotaka kubadilisha mfumo, turudishe nguvu kwa wananchi. Tukumbuke mapinduzi ya Afrika yalipigwa na wananchi, lakini viongozi walipokuja kuyashika na kukaa kwenye mikutano waliwalagai na kuwauza wananchi. Tunatengeneza taasisi, lakini mwalimu alisema taasisi za demokrasia, kwa sababu zako ni taasisi lakini ni chombo cha ubepari. Kwa hiyo kwangu mimi naungana na profesa kwamba tumeona viongozi wachafu, lakini mfumo unawa place, unawapa fursa za kuwa wachafu. Kwa hiyo ni lazima tuelewe mfumo mzima unafanyaje kazi na tools zake ni zipi. Mimi naogopa sana hizo lugha za taasisi, equality, kwa sababu wakoloni ni lugha zao hizo. Katiba na kila kitu. Kwa mimi narudi kwa sababu iliyomfanya Sankara kawawa, akawawa hani wa South Africa, akawawa Lipumba kwa sababu walitaka kubadili mfumo wa kiuchumi. Na ni lazima uanze na dira kubwa kama mwalimu, alibadilisha elimu, alibadilisha siasa na kila kitu, kutengeneza mfumo mpya. Kama ambavyo wazu.
That is the question, and even those of you who are from the Muslims, many Muslims here will know the great hadith writings of Abu Huraira. When the prophet had been poisoned and he was dying, The comfort of the prophet is that he had his sahabas. You who are here, are these your sahabas? Will they sell us to Europe and America? The question is yours. Choose you now. The Chinese have chosen. They are coming here. And they will be here. There is a phone that I acquired recently called the Techno. In the next 5 years, out of every 10 phones, 9 will be Techno. China knows what it wants. Do we are 1.3 billion, do we know what we want since you are Africa? How, in the words of Nyerere, tunabaki kushangana kuduatu. I know it can't. Tanzania, when one talks about hygiene, one must start in the 1960s. One must remember the Arusha Declaration and the nobility of the intentions of Mwalimu Julius Kambarage Nyerere. And that is why many of you may not know, but at one time it was suggested that he be made a saint of the Catholic Church. And the reason was very simple. This was a man who had ideas. This was a man who had clarity of thought. This was a man who could see the future almost with the exactitude of a Jewish prophet. This was a man who had the humility, almost like the humility of the carpenter of Nazareth. This was a man who loved his country. He made mistakes, and when he made them, he realized and corrected them. That is his greatness. Is it not Saint Just who said that nobody can rule guiltlessly? This is a man who found 120 plus ethnic groups and welded them into one niche so that Tanzanians speak with one voice. You know, if you look at Tanzania and you ask your typical Tanzanian what was the ethnic extraction of President Kambarage Nyerere, they do not know and they do not care. If you ask Tanzanians what was the ethnic extraction of the second president of Tanzania, Mzee Ali Hassan Mwinyi, the Tanzanians do not know and they do not care because it does not matter. If you ask them what was the ethnic extraction of the third president of Tanzania, Benjamin William Mkapa, they do not know and it does not matter and they do not care. And if you ask Tanzania what was the ethnic extraction of your fourth president, Jakaya Mrisho Kikwete, they do not know and they do not care. And if you ask them what is the extraction of your fifth president, John Pombe Magufuli, they do not know and they do not care. They only know that he's a bulldozer. But you go to my country, Kenya, God save my country. God save my country. When you meet your typical Kenyan and you introduce yourself as John, they'll ask for the second name, not that they may know your full names, but that they may identify you with your ethnicity and pigeonhole you accordingly. When you go into that country, which is a great country in prospect, but which is being destroyed by negative ethnicity, you ask them who the first president of Kenya was, they'll tell you it was Jomo Kenyatta and he was Kikuyu, and we care. We want our Kikuyu president. And if you ask them who was the second president, they'll tell you it was Daniel Arap Moi of the Kalenjin extraction, and we cared because it was our turn to eat. And if you ask them who was the third president, they'll tell you it is Uhuru Muigai Kenyatta, and he is a Kikuyu, and we want him to continue because we Kikuyus and we Kalenjin only feel safe when one of our own is in State House. And if you ask the opposition and you ask the leaders, you ask the leaders from my own ethnic group, the Luo of Kenya, the Luo will tell you we have been marginalized for too long. The time has come that God must smile upon us and our son must be the president. And if you ask the Luhyas, they'll say the same thing. That is the tragedy of gigantic proportions. I'm submitting to us that the country called Kenya needs political hygiene. I'm submitting to us that the country called Kenya needs to come to Tanzania here on a benchmarking tour, and that the President of the Republic of Kenya and all our parliamentarians should sit at the State House and be lectured by John Pombe Magufuli on the finer points of governance. Of course, Mzee Warioba will be there, and other stalwarts will be there. Salim Ahmed Salim will be there. Great Tanzanians will be there. And Nyerere will remind us, katika karne ya 21 tupande basi ya makabila ujinga na upumbavu. Because it can destroy a nation. There is need for political hygiene in Kenya. Right now in...
Happiness is not getting what you want all the time. It's about loving what you have and being grateful for it. The strongest people are not always the people who win, but the people who don't give up when they lose. I don't regret the things I have done. I regret the things I didn't do when I had the chance. Get up today and say, this is going to be a great day. I'm excited about my future. Something good is going to happen to me. Sometimes we need someone to simply be there, not to fix anything or do.
And because of coronavirus, we have not been able to go to school and learn. But it doesn't mean that we should stop learning. Me here, I have Brain Planet that will help me learn and give me some work to do. Brain Planet is an app that helps, that gives children work. You can learn, and then when we go back to school, we can be able to pass tests and exams. For example, Brain Planet has given me this work, and the first question says, a pen costs shillings 400. Find the cost of two similar pens. If you want to find the cost of two similar pens, get the price of one pen and add it two times. And the second question says, what is the product of 6 and 20? And the key of this question is the word product. And product means multiplication. So you get 20 multiplied by 6 and the answer will be 120. And I want to thank my mommy for assisting me with her phone and teaching me how to do this. All you have to do is write www.thebrainplanet.com. You can also try this.
Yes, welcome our dear viewers. You're live on the Youth TV and we are on Facebook and as well as YouTube. Yes, today we are hosting a big man. And in the next few minutes, I will be introducing him. Before that, yes, the 11th Parliament will have actually 5 affirmative seats. We are talking about MP representing the youth, the elderly, the women, as well as AME and people with disabilities. And for the youth MP, those ones will be represented by actually 5 MPs in Parliament, one representing Western Northern Region, another one representing Eastern, Central, as well as National Female Youth MP. So today on Youth TV, we are live with Honorable Denmark Adios. Honorable Denmark, you're welcome on Youth TV.
Well, good morning, our dear viewers and followers on Youth TV. On Facebook. My name is Denmark Adios Winomisha, most referred to as the revolutionary son, a bright boy, FDC domain. And this is because of my bold civil activist means in agitating for change.
Who is Denmark? Our viewers might be wondering, who is that Denmark, the revolutionary son?
Wonderful. Denmark Adios is a small, tall boy, born and raised from Mukunjiri, Ugangari, sub-county, Kazindo Parish, Bujumbura, USA. Like I said, I'm an FDC double main. I'm a candidate of FDC. I'm a flag bearer of FDC for youth member of Parliament of Western Region.
So before we proceed, in your opinion, do we actually need these affirmative seats? Are the young people benefiting from having a representative in Parliament?
For the last 15 years, a few have benefited from this. And the few I'm talking about are the few who have. What do I mean by this? Previously, the seats you're talking about have been seen as the seats of the rich, young people, are the seats of the young children of ministers, are the seats for the people who have connections with State House. I've come challenge the status quo. That's why a humble boy from a humble family is also participating in this election. The reason why I say it's important, their views must be represented, the youth's problems and issues must be addressed, and of course, they must be addressed within the national parliament.
Okay. For young people out there who are watching us on Youth TV, actually, Youth TV is a TV, a youth-based TV. And maybe they could be wondering, what is the role of youth MP, the specific roles of youth MP?
The specific roles of youth member of parliament are no different from the roles of the member of parliament for either Rujumbura constituency, either Mbarara City, either Kunji municipality. They are the same roles. There's no big difference. The roles is to represent the people who have empowered you or entrusted you to be in the parliament, to be their voice. That's the biggest roles the youth member of parliament have.
Okay. So walk us through the journey. How has it been? How far have you gone with campaigns, and what should our young people watching us expect from you in a few days from now?
Obviously, it's not easy, just because we are competing with two big horses, or three, who have got a lot of money from different sources. And like I said, me, I'm from a humble family. My father is a nobody person, he's a peasant. And the other people I'm contesting with, of course, they have all resources, they have all chances, talk of state machinery, talk of state money, which is quite stressing. That's why I believe that the majority who are oppressed have now got the right to either sell their soul, sell their integrity, or prove the public that together we can.
All right. So, Honorable Denmark, you're contesting on FDC ticket, and people could be wondering, is FDC still popular among the youth? Are you not threatened by the new wave among the youth?
Not at all. I know the FDC ideology, and the people understand the FDC ideology, are still there for FDC, except those who can be easily moved by the wave. We welcome the wave. After all, we all believe in changing the society. I'm a change agent. I'm not surprised by the wave of no. I'm actually happy with it.
Okay. Our young people out there could be wondering, you're going to a parliament that is full of NRM. At least they have more than 300 MPs. And now the service delivery has been tagged onto the party you belong to. So most people think if you want to deliver a service, you must belong to NRM. So how will you ensure you provide service even when you're on FDC ticket? Aren't young people threatened thinking you'll be there and you will not access the national cake, and even and then at the end of the day you will not represent them?
My friend, Mr. Moderator, my manifesto is completely hinged on three major points. And one of them is youth empowerment and action planning. If I talk of youth empowerment and action planning, I truly believe that now it is the role of the right, it's the role of the youth to mobilize, organize, sensitize, and make awareness to their fellow youth. The moment they organize themselves, now it becomes their right to claim for what belongs to them. As an individual, I won't promise anybody that I'm going to build hospitals, construct schools, or construct roads. My role is actually to articulate, to agitate, and inform the public, the youth who I'm going to represent, that this belongs to you. Now it's your turn. Cooperate with me and claim, because it belongs to us.
Okay. So you're talking about your manifesto. So let's look at it. You have pillars in your manifesto, one of it being youth empowerment
and action planning,
then tracking rural poverty among the youth, as well as education and youth employment. Let's talk about fostering peace among the people, as well as promoting agriculture. Then you also talk about positive and result-oriented representation. So walk us through, where do you base on to come up with these points? Are they based, which issues are you focusing on to come up with these issues in your manifesto?
You see, like I told you, I'm born and raised from a humble family, meaning that the challenges that are affecting the majority of the youth are the challenges that have affected me. So for me to come up with such a manifesto, I believe they are the challenges that needed to be addressed as urgent as of now, as early as of now. So it shouldn't surprise you or surprise anybody why not building schools, why not focusing on construction. I know that's impossible with me. I'm anti-government. I don't speak the same language as Mr. Museveni. I actually speak the language of the opposition, meaning that I expect disappointment somewhere, somehow. But much as I expect disappointment, I know the few things that are in my manifesto can be easily fulfilled without his assistance, because I've got friends from different areas. Talk of employment. We can obey. We have got friends in different countries where we can connect our fellow youth, go and work from. Talk of education. Education not about going to school. Recently, I was looking at launching a civic campaign magazine. Civic campaign is about education. We need to sensitize and let people know what is theirs, what's not theirs, where are their boundaries, what can they do to reach their objectives. That's education. Okay. Education is not about going to school. We have gone to schools, have friends who can offer free services.
to our young brothers and sisters who are in the villages. That's education. So, like I said from the beginning, youth empowerment and action planning shields a lot of things, which of I cannot talk and maybe exist at the moment. But there are very many things under those three main points.
So how can young people out there believe in you? How can they be sure that actually Denmark has the capacity to deliver on what he's talking about?
I'm a tested leader. I've been a good president of over 8,000 students in a big university. That's Bishop Stuart University. Core in of them, they will tell you this is a leader. Actually, the majority of them are behind me. Yeah. They are my people up to date. And it's very hard for a leader to live and you live with your people. Most of the times you live when they are cursing. So it's not just a blessing, it's just because I've worked for them, and surely I have a recommendation for them. They are all young people. Yes.
Okay. You come up with key points in your manifesto, and which I believe they touch on that common young man or young woman in the village. For instance, the issue of education and employment. We have quite a number, we have seen from reports, we have the biggest percentage of young people out there who are not in education or in any training, and they are not in employment. So one would be wondering, what is the policy alternative? What is Denmark going to do to make sure such young people also have their voice represented in the in Parliament of Uganda?
You see, for so long I've been telling my fellow youths that nothing for us without us. It's not about Denmark. This is not a war between Denmark and the government. It's the war between the young generation and the government. Through advocacy and activism, we can achieve our goals. We have a right to advocate for what is entitled to us. We have a right to fight for what belongs to us. We have a right to claim for them. So it's all about the younger generation. Like I said from the beginning, I know the majority of the electorates we have today, the majority of the delegates we have today, we share a lot in common. We face the same challenges. We are eating the same meal. Actually, most of us have been raised in the same houses. So it's up to them to either sell their soul or integrity or vote for something that they know and they are rest assured that it's going to happen.
Talk about the policy alternative you're going to advance in the August House.
You see, when talk about the policy alternative, I'll automatically move you to a point I may call, I may term as investigative research. As Denmark and Denmark as an individual, surely I cannot lie that I will raise this policy alternative. It's about people to guide me on which policy and how best can we implement and table this one before the parliament.
But you as a leader, you have a role.
Obviously, this will happen once I'm entrusted and empowered by the young people.
You as a leader, you have a role to play before other people come on board. For instance, we remember in the tennis parliament, Honorable Mpaka had initiated a policy to do with helping young graduates. Whenever they graduate, we have an apprenticeship program where they go to and acquire skills which they can use to get employment opportunities.
Mr. Moderator, look at me and look at Honorable Mpaka. Honorable Mpaka is a son to Honorable Bright Rwamirama, who is the Minister of Agriculture in this country. I'm a son to nobody. I'm a son to PISA. Even if I say a lot before the parliament, I'm not sure a lot I've said will be implemented. Therefore, I must say, which I'm sure, that's the reason why I'm saying, it's advocacy and activism. I know the youth who are hungry, I can mobilize them and reclaim for what they want to do. It's not about tabling issues on the parliament. It's about sensitization and awareness. Let the people know what belongs to them. Let the people understand how best they can claim for that.
Yes. That's why young people would be sure, they want to be sure there is, you have a process. You have a policy direction when it comes to youth employment. You have policy when it comes to getting opportunities that
such
belong to them.
Such policies have been raised and implemented, but how many have benefited out of them? It's not about raising issues in the parliament. It's about action planning. It's about action.
Okay. So the issue of accountability. Whenever young people at the moment are not getting what they deserve, simply because what belongs to them is taken away by people who are aware of the people you're calling the rich,
the sons of the rich.
What's your policy on accountability when it comes to people who are misusing
things that are meant for young people. Talk of youth livelihood fund. Young people have not benefited from it. And they are looking up to you as their representative in parliament to make sure you advocate for them so that they get exactly what see, belongs to them. What's your view on that?
See, I'm surprised, Mr. Moderator, that your questions are rotating on my only one answer. And that only one answer I have is sensitization. Are these youths aware that there is youth livelihood fund? Are they aware? Will they know where to get that money from? Therefore, my biggest role as a leader, once I'm entrusted, is to first sensitize them. They must know the source of that money, how best they can claim for it, where they can get it from, how to use it. The majority are not aware. That's why that money is even used by useless people.
Okay.
The so-called useful idiots, the likes of Baram. Find Baram is claiming to be a youth, he's a mobilizer of youth, even when he's in his 40s. Therefore, the biggest role we have is to educate, to teach, and plan for this and work with them. We must lead them. The moment you get an organized leader, then you reach the promised land.
Okay. Yes. So you bring out the issue of agriculture.
Yes.
And yes, we know agriculture is Uganda's backbone of our economy.
Mm.
And most times we see agriculture contributing 25% of Uganda's GDP.
Mm.
Unfortunately, that contribution does not come from the youth.
Mm.
For instance, 80% of production is contributed by women, not actually youth.
Mm.
Yet 70% of Uganda's population is actually comprised of youth.
Mm.
So what are you going to do? At least you have highlighted agriculture in your
fortunately, I'm a student of agribusiness.
Oh, yes.
I know what agriculture means, both in the face of our parents and the face of the young people. In the face of our parents, agriculture mainly, most especially in the Western region, is a source of income. In the face of the young people, my brothers and sisters, it is a dirty work which they would not love to do because they don't want to look dirty. But agriculture, as an agribusinessman, I understand agriculture as crop growing, rearing of animals, and value addition as well. If you can't do crop growing or farming, add value. So it's my role now to sit with a team that is focused, that is aiming at achieving objectives, and which change the face of agriculture. We can either focus on branding, we can either focus on packaging, and this will help our youth, one, in gaining much of employment opportunities, secondly, in raising much at the levels of the source. Because once you package, once you brand, of course, you increase sales. It can't remain like when you're selling either a single avocado, a single passion fruit. But if you make it, if you extract that passion fruit and make it juice out of it, that's a value addition. And you earn much out of it compared when you're selling it alone as a fruit. So
okay. It's
just a matter of changing the face of agriculture. Like I said, our mothers and our fathers see agriculture source of income. But our young brothers and sisters see agriculture as a dirty job. So it's not about changing it. You must add value in it. You must add the sugar and make it appear.
Easier to say than to do. Because your role as a member of parliament, you'll be advocating.
Obviously.
And there is an improvement. So there is a problem at the implementation level. So yes, after advocating, what more will you do? Because you are sensitized, you will advocate, but there is that implementer who might not do the work. Do you have any idea about...
My duty as a member of parliament, once I'm entrusted, is to make a forum and ensure that every person at his level, at his stage, does what he or she is supposed to do.
Okay.
Yes.
Yes, you are a student of agriculture. Yes, you have finished, actually.
Yeah.
Is there any, because for instance, they are saying they are not going to be in the new curriculum. Agriculture is optional. Do you think that is a disservice to young people, or in your opinion, no problem?
In my own reasoning and my own understanding, it's not a disservice.
Okay.
We claim to be in a democratic country. Therefore, everybody has got his or her own choice.
Okay.
As long as it's there, whoever picks interest in agriculture will go and study agriculture. Whoever doesn't pick interest in it, it's fine. He or she can help us in one way or another.
Okay.
Yes.
So, you're live on Youth TV, and you're going to use this platform to tell young people out there all that you think you're focused on, and you give them your last words as we conclude this interview.
Well, first and foremost, I must remind my fellow young brothers and sisters that this war is not the war between Denmark and either other candidates. It's a war of liberating yourselves. We are in captivity, and nothing for us without us. Therefore, I call you and appeal to you, come and we fight, liberate ourselves. Come and we fight, we claim for what belongs to us. Come and we fight, we change our community. Because we believe, as young generation, we are the change agents and we are the leaders of today and tomorrow. I thank you very much and have a blessed day.
Yes, thank you so much. That was Honorable Denmark Adios, who is actually one of the contestants in the Western Youth Parliamentary Race, and he is contesting on FDC ticket. Thank you so much. From 2 to 6 p.m., we are going to have Must Guild presidential debate, and it will be live again on Facebook and on YouTube. Today we are looking at how the 6 contestants in the Guild parliamentary, the Guild presidential race at Must will be tussling it out, and whoever will take the day, we will wait and see. I remain Trevor Ronald, and thank you so much for watching 8 TV.